The Swiss Family Robinson, or Adventures on a Desert Island, by Johann David Wyss. This unabridged recording is produced by Jim Hodges of jimhodgesaudiobooks.com. Chapter 1. Shipwrecked. For many days we had been tempest-tossed. 6 times had the darkness covered over a wild and terrific scene, and returning light as often brought renewed distress, for the raging storm increased in fury, until on the 7th day all hope was lost. We were driven completely out of our course. No conjecture could be formed as to our whereabouts. The crew had lost heart, and were utterly exhausted by incessant labor. The riven masts had gone by the board, leaks had been sprung in every direction, and the water which rushed in gained upon us rapidly. Instead of reckless oaths, the seamen now uttered frantic cries to God for mercy, mingled with strange and often ludicrous vows, to be performed should deliverance be granted. Every man on board alternately commended his soul to his Creator and strove to bethink himself of some means of saving his life. My heart sank as I looked round upon my family in the midst of these horrors. Our 4 young sons were overpowered by terror. "Dear children," said I, "if the Lord will, He can save us even from this fearful peril. If not, let us calmly yield our lives into His hand, and think of the joy and blessedness of finding ourselves forever and ever united in that happy home above." At these words my weeping wife looked bravely up, and as the boys clustered round her she began to cheer and encourage them with calm and loving words. I rejoiced to see her fortitude, though my heart was ready to break as I gazed on my dear ones. We knelt down together one after another, praying with deep earnestness and emotion. Fritz in particular besought help and deliverance for his dear parents and brothers, as though quite forgetting himself. Our hearts were soothed by the never-failing comfort of childlike, confiding prayer, and the horror of our situation seemed less overwhelming. "Ah," thought I, "the Lord will hear our prayer. He will help us." Amid the roar of the thundering waves, I suddenly heard the cry of "Land! Land!" while at the same instant the ship struck with a frightful shock which threw everyone to the deck and seemed to threaten her immediate destruction. Dreadful sounds betokened the breaking up of the ship, and the roaring waters poured in on all sides. Then the voice of the captain was heard above the tumult shouting, "Lower away the boats! We are lost!" "Lost!" I exclaimed, and the word went like a dagger to my heart. But seeing my children's terror renewed, I composed myself, calling out cheerfully, "Take courage, my boys, we are all above water yet. There is the land not far off. Let us do our best to reach it. You know God helps those that help themselves." With that, I left them and went on deck. What was my horror when through the foam and spray I beheld the only remaining boat leave the ship, the last of the seamen springing into her and push off, regardless of my cries and entreaties that we might be allowed to share their slender chance of preserving their lives. My voice was drowned in the howling of the blast, and even had the crew wished it, the return of the boat was impossible. Casting my eyes despairingly around, I became gradually aware that our position was by no means hopeless, inasmuch as the stern of the ship containing our cabin was jammed between 2 high rocks and was partly raised from among the breakers which dashed the forepart to pieces. As the clouds of mist and rain drove past, I could make out through rents in the vaporous curtain a line of rocky coast, and rugged as it was, my heart bounded toward it as a sign of help in the hour of need. Yet the sense of our lonely and forsaken condition weighed heavily upon me as I returned to my family, constraining myself to say with a smile, "Courage, dear ones. Although our good ship will never sail more, she is so placed that our cabin will remain above water, and tomorrow, if the wind and waves abate, I see no reason why we should not be able to get ashore." These few words had an immediate effect on the spirits of my children, who at once regarded our problematical chance of escaping as a happy certainty, and began to enjoy the relief from the violent pitching and rolling of the vessel. My wife, however, perceived my distress and anxiety, in spite of my forced composure, and I made her comprehend our real situation, greatly fearing the effect of the intelligence on her nerves. Not for a moment did her courage and trust in Providence forsake her.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.